difference on this beginning of the Holy Week on Sunday. We have come together to join Jesus in his solemn entry to Jerusalem and then the Passion, death, and of course the Resurrection. For reasons we know, we have limitations. We are going to bring our service completely. The many of us who are not able to join physically, we remember all of you, especially the faithful of the Rector community. And we are here walking with the Lord. And at this moment, as we go through prayerfully in this solemn entry with the Holy Eucharist, let's bring our prayers. Maybe many of us, we have sorrow within, fear within, and also not able to attend. We were so part of this all through our life. As the Holy Father invites, if you feel that you are missing the Lord, then he is all the more closer to you today. And maybe some of us, not able to make a confession, want to be so renewed before the Lord. Put yourself, ask the Lord pardon, and assure him that the next probably possible option, I will turn to the Lord in confession. And let's, in a moment of silence, bring ourselves, our families, near and dear ones, and walk with Jesus so that we experience this glorification in our life. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Dear friends, since the beginning of Lent until now, we have prepared our hearts by penance and charitable works. Today we gather together to herald with the whole Church the beginning of this celebration, our Lord's Paschal Mystery, that is to say, of his Passion and Resurrection. For it was to accomplish this mystery that he entered his own city of Jerusalem. Therefore, with all the faithful and devotion, let us commemorate Lord's entry into the city of salvation, following in his footsteps. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, sanctify these branches with your blessing, that we who follow Christ, the King in exaltation, may reach eternal Jerusalem through him, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
We will now bless the palm leaves, those of us who are participating spiritually from homes. If you have your leaves, hold it, the Lord is blessing. And then, as we sing this song, we will ask the Lord really to renew us from within.
902, number
902. The King of glory comes to mission, rejoices. Open the gates before him, lift up your voices. Who is the King of glory? How shall we call him? He is Emmanuel, the promise of ages. The King of glory, consternation rejoices. Open the gates before him, lift up your voices.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew. Glory to you, O Lord. Chapter 21, verses 1 to 11. When they were near Jerusalem and had come in sight of Bethphage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village facing you, and you will immediately find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, you are to say, 'The master needs them,' and he will send back them once he finishes." This took place to fulfill the prophecy said to daughter of Zion, "Look, your king comes to you. He is humble, he rides on a donkey." So the disciples went and did as Jesus told them. They brought the donkey and the colt, Then they laid their cloaks on their back and sat on them. Great crowds of people spread their cloaks on the road, with others were cutting branches from the trees and spreading them in his path. The crowds who went in front of him and those who followed were all shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessings on him who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heavens." And when he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was in turmoil. "Who is this?" people asked. And the crowds answered, "This is a prophet, Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Dear friends, a short reflection as we walk into the rest of the Mass. The reading that we heard, the first part, is the solemn entry into Jerusalem. And now at the altar, we have the celebration, what Jesus will experience, the sacrifice. The Gospel says, the Lord kneads it, the donkey. I think that is what he's telling each of us. The Master kneads us. Let's give ourselves completely to the Lord. Let us stand. Now we begin the second part of this day's celebration, that is the Holy Eucharist and the altar. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, who, as an example of humility for the human race to follow, caused our Saviour to take flesh and submit to the cross, graciously grant that we may listen to his lesson of patient suffering and so merit a share in his holy resurrection, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen.
We'll be listening to two readings. Those of us who have the Holy Week book, you can follow it from page 6 onwards.
A reading from the prophet Isaiah. The Lord has given me a disciple's tongue, so that I may know how to reply to the weary. He provides me with speech. Each morning he wakes me to hear, to listen like a disciple. The Lord has opened my ear. For my part, I made no resistance. Neither did I turn away. I offered my back to those who struck me, my cheeks to those who tore at my beard. I did not cover my face against insult and spittle. The Lord comes to my help so that I am untouched by the insults. So too, I set my face like flint. I know I shall not be shamed. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let your response be, my God, why have you forsaken me?
My God, why have you forsaken me?
All who see me deride me. They curl their lips, they toss their heads. He trusted in the Lord, let him save him. Let him release him, if this is his friend. Your response?
My God, why have you forsaken me?
Many dogs have surrounded me. A band of the wicked beset me. They tear holes in my hands and feet. I can count every one of my bones. Your response?
My God, why have you forsaken me?
They divide my clothing among them. They cast lots for my robe. O Lord, do not leave me alone. My strength, make haste to help me. Your response?
My God, why have you forsaken me?
I will tell of your name to my brethren and praise you when they are assembled. You who fear the Lord, give him praise. All sons of Jacob, give him glory. Revere him, Israel's sons. Your response?
My God, why have you forsaken me?
letter of Paul to the Christians of Philippi. His state was divine, yet Christ did not cling to the equality with God, but emptied himself to assume the condition of a slave, and became as men are. And being as all men are, he was humbler yet, even to accepting death on a cross. But God raised him high and gave him the name which is above all other names, so that all beings in the heavens, on earth, and in the underworld should bend the knee at the name of Jesus, and that every tongue should acclaim Jesus Christ as Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Acclamation. Christ was humbler yet, even to accepting death on the cross, but God raised him high and gave him the name which is above all names.
We are going to listen to the Passion narration from Matthew's version. Let's carefully go through and listen. This is the journey of the Lord. Let's walk with him so that we can experience in our life the true glorification. Page 17, those of us who follow from the book. The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
One of the 12, the man called Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priests and said,
What are you prepared to give me if I hand him over to you?
They paid him 30 silver pieces, and from that moment he looked for an opportunity to betray him. Now on the first day of unleavened bread, the disciples came to Jesus to see,
Where do you want us to make the preparations for you to eat the Passover?
Jesus replied,
Go to so-and-so in the city and say to him, The master says, My time is near. It is at your house that I am keeping the Passover to my disciples.
The disciples did what Jesus told them and prepared the Passover. When evening came, he was at a table with the 12 disciples, and while they were eating, he said,
I tell you solemnly, one of you is about to betray me.
They were greatly distressed and started asking him in turn,
Not I, Lord, surely.
He answered,
Someone who has dipped his hand into the dish with me will betray me. The Son of Man is going to be betrayed, as the scriptures say he will. But alas for that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. Better for that man if he had never been born.
Judas, who was to betray him, asked in his turn,
Not I, Lord, surely.
Jesus answered,
They are your own words.
Now as they were eating, Jesus took some bread, and when he had said the blessing, he broke it and gave it to the disciples, saying,
Take it and eat. This is my body.
Then he took a cup, and when he had returned thanks, he gave it to them, saying,
Drink all of you from this, for this is my blood, the blood of the covenant, which is to be poured out for many for the forgiveness of their sins. From now on, I tell you, I shall not drink wine until the day I drink the new wine with you in the kingdom of my Father.
After psalms had been sung, they left for the Mount of Olives. Then Jesus said to them,
You will all lose faith in me this night, for the scripture says, I shall strike the shepherd and the sheep of the flock will be scattered. But after my resurrection, I shall go before you to Galilee.
At this, Peter said,
Though all will save you, I have never been saved.
Jesus answered him,
I tell you solemnly, this very night, before the cock crows, you will have disowned me 3 times.
Peter said to him,
Even if I have to die with you, I will never disown you.
And all the disciples said the same. Then Jesus came with them to a small estate called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples,
"Stay here while I go over there to pray."
He took Peter and the two sons of Zebedee with him, and sadness came over him and great distress. Then he said to them,
"My soul is sorrowful to the point of death. Wait here and keep awake with me.
I'm going to a little further." He fell on his face and prayed,
"My Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass me by. Nevertheless, let it be as you, not I, would have it."
He came back to the disciples and found them sleeping, and he said to Peter,
"So you have not the strength to keep awake with me an hour. You should be awake and pray, not to be put to the test. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak."
Again, a second time, he went away and prayed, saying,
"My Father, if this cup cannot pass by without my drinking it, your will be done."
And he came again back and found them sleeping. Their eyes were so heavy. Leaving them there, he went away again and prayed for the third time, repeating the same words. Then he came back to the disciples and said to them,
"You can sleep on now and take your rest. Now the hour has come when the Son of Man is to be betrayed into the hands of the sinners. Get up, let us go. My betrayer is already close at hand."
He was still speaking when Judas, one of the 12, appeared, and with him a large number of men armed with swords and clubs, sent by the chief priests and elders of the people. Now the traitor had arranged a sign with them. He had said,
"The one I kiss, he is a man. Take him in charge."
So he went straight up to Jesus and said,
"Greetings, Rabbi,"
and kissed him. Jesus said to him,
"My friend, do what you are here for."
Then they came forward, seized Jesus, and took him in charge. At that, one of the followers of Jesus grabs his sword and drew it. He struck out at the high priest's servant and cut off his ear. Jesus then said,
"Put your sword back, for all who draw the sword will die by it. Or do you think that I cannot appeal to my Father, who would promptly send more than 12 legions of angels to my defense? But then, how would the scriptures be fulfilled that say, 'This is the way it must be'?"
It was at this time that Jesus said to the crowd,
"Am I a brigand that you have to set out to capture me with swords and clubs? I sat teaching in the temple day after day, and you never laid hands on me."
Now all this happened to fulfill the prophecies in scripture. Then all the disciples deserted him and ran away. The men who had arrested Jesus led him off to Caiaphas, the high priest, where the scribes and the elders were assembled. Peter followed him at a distance, and when he reached the high priest's palace, he went in and sat down with the attendants to see what the end would be. The chief priests and the whole Sanhedrin were looking for evidence against Jesus, however false, on which they might pass the death sentence, but they could not find any. Though several lying witnesses came forward, eventually two stepped forward and made a statement.
"This man said, 'I have power to destroy the temple of God, and in 3 days I will rise.'"
The high priest then stood up and said to him,
"Have you no answer to that? What is this evidence this man are bringing against you?"
But Jesus was silent, and the high priest said to him,
"I put you on oath by the living God to tell us if you are Christ, the Son of the Lord."
Jesus answered,
"The words are your own. Moreover, I tell you that from this time onward, you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming on the clouds of heaven."
At this, the high priest tore his clothes and said,
He has blasphemed. What need of witnesses is coming now? There you have just heard blasphemy. What is your opinion?
They answered,
He deserves to die.
Then they spat in his face and hit him with their fists. Others said, as they struck him,
Lay the prophet Christ, who is to them.
Meanwhile, Peter was sitting outside in the courtyard, and a servant girl came up to him and said,
You too are with Jesus as the heaven.
But he denied it in front of them all. He said,
I do not know what you are talking about.
When he went out to the gateway, another servant girl saw him and said to the people there,
This man was with Jesus in the Nazarene.
And again, with an oath, he denied it.
I do not know the man.
A little later, the bystanders came up and said to Peter,
You are one of them for sure. Why your accent gives you away?
Then he started calling down curses on himself and swearing,
I do not know the man.
At that moment, the cock crew. And Peter remembered what Jesus had said, Before the cock crows, you will have disowned me 3 times. And he went outside and wept bitterly. When morning came, all the chief priests and elders of the people met in council to bring about the death of Jesus. They had him bound and led him away to hand him over to Pilate, the governor. When he found that Jesus had been condemned, Judas, his betrayer, was filled with remorse and took the 30 silver pieces back to the chief priests and elders. He said,
I have sinned. I have betrayed innocent blood.
They replied,
What is that to us? That is your concern.
And fleeing down the silver pieces in the sanctuary he made of, and went and hanged himself. The chief priest picked up the silver pieces and said,
It is against the law to put this into the treasury. It is blood money.
So they discussed the matter and bought the potter's field with it as a graveyard for foreigners. And this is why the field is called the field of blood today. The words of the prophet Jeremiah were then fulfilled, and they took the 30 silver pieces, the sum at which the precious one was prized by the children of Israel, and they gave them for the potter's field, just as the Lord directed me. Jesus then was brought before the governor, and the governor put him this question,
Are you the king of the Jews?
Jesus replied,
It is you who say it.
But when he was accused by the chief priests and the elders, he refused to answer at all. Pilate then said to him,
Do you not hear how many charges they have brought against you?
But to the governor's complete amazement, he offered no reply to any of the charges. At festival time, it was the governor's practice to release a prisoner for the people, anyone they chose. Now there was at that time a notorious prisoner whose name was Barabbas. So when the crowd gathered, Pilate said to them,
Which do you want me to release for you, Barabbas or Jesus, who is called Christ?
For Pilate knew it was out of jealousy that they had handed him over. Now as he was seated in the chair of judgment, his wife sent him a message. Have nothing to do with that man. I have been upset all day by a dream I had about him. The chief priests and the elders, however, had persuaded the crowd to demand the release of Barabbas and the execution of Jesus. So when the governor spoke and asked them, Which of the two do you want me to release for you? They said,
Barabbas.
Pilate said to them,
But in that case, what am I to do with Jesus, who is called Christ?
They all said,
Let him be crucified.
He asked,
Why, what harm has he done?
But they shouted all the louder,
Let him be crucified.
Then Pilate saw that he was making no impression, that in fact a riot was imminent. So he took some water, washed his hands in front of the crowd and said,
I am innocent of this man's blood. It is your concern.
And the people, to a man, shouted back,
His blood be on us and on our children.
Then he released Barabbas for them. He ordered Jesus to be the first scourge and then handed over to be crucified. The governor's soldiers took Jesus with them into the praetorium and collected the whole cohort round him. Then they stripped him and made him wear a scarlet cloak. And having twisted some thorns into a crown, they put this on his head and placed a reed in his right hand to make fun of him. They knelt to him, saying,
Hail, King of the Jews!
And they spat on him and took the reed and struck him on the head with it. And when they had finished making fun of him, they took off the cloak and dressed him in his own clothes and led him away to crucify him. On their way out, they came across a man from Simon by name, and enlisted him to carry his cross. When they had reached a place called Golgotha, that is, the place of the skull, they gave him wine to drink, mixed with gall, which he tasted but refused to drink. When they had finished crucifying him, they shared out his clothing by casting lots, and then sat down and stayed there, keeping guard over him. Above his head was placed the charge against him. It read, This is Jesus, the King of the Jews. At the same time, two robbers were crucified with him, one on the right and one on the left. The passers-by jeered at him. They shook their heads and said,
So you would destroy the temple and build it in 3 days. Then save yourself. If you are God's son, come down from the cross.
The chief priests with the scribes and elders mocked him in the same way. They said,
He saved others. He cannot have saved himself. He is the King of Israel. Let him come down from the cross now, and we will believe in him. He puts his trust in God. Now let God rescue him, if he wants him. For he did say, I am the Son of God.
Even the robbers who were crucified with him taunted him in the same way. From the sixth hour there was darkness over all the land until the ninth hour. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out in a loud voice,
Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani.
That is, my God, why have you deserted me? When some of those who stood there heard this, they said,
The man is calling on Elijah.
And one of them quickly ran to get a sponge, which he dipped in vinegar, and putting it on a reed, gave it to him to drink. Said the rest of them,
Wait and see if Elijah will come to save him.
But Jesus, again crying out in a loud voice, yielded up his spirit.
Bless me.
rocks were split, the tombs opened, the bodies of many holy men rose from the dead. And these, after his resurrection, came out of the tombs, entered the holy city, and appeared to a number of people. Meanwhile, the centurion, together with the others guarding Jesus, had seen the earthquake and all that was taking place, and they were terrified and said,
"In truth, this was the Son of God."
And many women were there, watching him from a distance, the same women who had followed Jesus from Galilee and looked after him. Among them were Mary of Magdala, Mary the mother of James, and Joseph, and the mother of Zebedee's sons. When it was evening, there came a rich man of Arimathea, called Joseph, who had himself become a disciple of Jesus. This man went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Pilate thereupon ordered it to be handed over. So Joseph took the body, wrapped it in a clean shroud, and put it in his own new tomb, which he had hewn out of the rock. He then rolled a large stone across the entrance of the tomb and went away. Now Mary of Magdala and the other Mary were there sitting opposite the sepulchre. Next day, that is, when preparation day was over, the chief priests and the Pharisee went in a body to Pilate and said to him,
"Your Excellency, we recall that his tomb was reset while he was still alive. After 3 days I shall rise again. Therefore, give the order to have the sepulchre kept secure until the very day, for fear his disciples come and steal him away and tell the people he has risen from the dead. This last piece of fraud would be worse than what went before."
Pilate said to them,
"You may have your God. Go and make all as secure as you know how."
So they went and made the sepulchre secure, putting seals on the stone and mounting a guard.
The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Dear friends, let us be silently seated for a minute and go through this passion narration. Where are we? Are we the accuser, Judas, Pilate? Or are we Peter, following at a distance? Or are we the ones standing by? Am I Simon of Cyrene? Or other women who stood by? Or those who followed close? Let's make the passion of Jesus into our life. Let us stand to profess our faith. I believe in God,
the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting.
Listen a moment of silence, bring our prayers and intentions to the Holy Lord. We pray for the Holy Church, for Francis and all the leaders, that at this time of crisis, the Lord may inspire and guide and lead them. We pray for our nation and its leaders. We pray for people in the health, doctors, nurses, scientists, the sick, those afflicted. We pray for those in sick beds. Pray for the departed. We pray for ourselves, for our families, that the Lord may protect, keep us, and dispel all fear from us. And this time of Holy Week, we may enter with a higher devotion and love to feel and experience the passion, death, and resurrection of the Lord. We make all this praise through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Number 81.
United in one body, Jesus Christ the Lord. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith, when we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you.
Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, our bishops, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters, all our near and dear ones departed, who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy, welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us, all we pray, that the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, St. Joseph, the Apostles, St. Anthony, St. John Bosco, and all the saints who pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God Almighty, Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Amen.
Let's pray for the coming of God's kingdom in us, in our families, and the prayer that Jesus himself taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil, and graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may always be free from all sin, safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give to you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant your peace and unity in accordance with your will, live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
Peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let's offer each other God's peace.
Lamb of God,
you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, grant us peace.
Behold Jesus, the Lamb of God, who takes away all our sins, the one who died for us, that we may live. Blessed are we who are called to save him.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed.
Those of us who cannot receive Jesus spiritually, cannot receive Jesus physically, let's ask him to come into us spiritually in his body and blood. Surrender your life to the Lord. Invite him. Ask him to pardon all your sins. Enter into your life, into your family, and transform you. As he enters into Jerusalem today, let him enter into our house, to our hearts, to our families, and let him dive in us. Let him make that resurrection in us.
this time Jesus was coming to us. Let's surrender our lives to Him, ask Him freely to transform us. And let's look within. Each of us will know where I need for the Lord's passion, death, and resurrection to take place, so that I will truly experience this Easter, a real change. For many of us, we are not able and we are sorrowful because we are not able to partake of this celebration physically. But let this be the day, let this be the time, the greatest change will take place in my heart, in my life. Because the Lord is ever closer to us at this event. And if there are anything that I need to do, let that be the greatest change that I'm going to do. And though not physically in, I'm sure the Lord can work the greatest miracle in our life, in our families. Tell the Lord, as the psalmist says, commit your life to the Lord and He will act on your behalf. Let us pray. Nourished with the sacred gifts, we humbly beseech you, O Lord, that just as through the death of your Son you have brought us hope for what we believe, so by his resurrection you may lead us to where you call, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow your heads and pray for God's blessings. Look, we pray, O Lord, on this your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ did not hesitate to be delivered into the hands of the sinners and submit to the agony of the cross, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
May the blessing of Almighty God, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit come down on you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Mass is ended. Let's go to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
As we say this prayer, let us ask, surrender our souls, especially during this holy week, to the world, to heal those affected, to protect those working.
Pray for protection from the virus, Corona. Triune God, we come to you in our weakness. We come to you in our fear. We come to you with a trust, for you alone are our hope. We place before you the disease present in our world. We turn to you in our time of need. Bring wisdom to doctors, give understanding to scientists. Endow caregivers with compassion and generosity. Bring healing to those who are ill. Protect those who are most at risk. Give comfort to those who have lost a loved one. Welcome those who have died into your eternal home. Stabilize our communities. Unite us in our compassion. Remove all fear from our hearts. Fill us with confidence in your care. Jesus, I trust in you. Jesus, I trust in you. Jesus, I trust in you. Amen. Pray to the Holy Family. Jesus, Mary, and Joseph, in you we contemplate the splendor of the true love. To you we turn with trust, Holy Family of Nazareth. Grant that our families too may be places of communion, prayer, and be authentic schools of the gospel and small domestic churches. Holy Family of Nazareth, may our families never again experience violence, rejection, and division. May all who have been hurt find ready comfort and healing. Holy Family of Nazareth, make us aware of the sacredness of the family and its beauty in God's plan. Jesus, Mary, and Joseph, graciously hear our prayer.
Just a small information for those of us who are watching from far and wide. Many of you calling and asking, Father, these days we are not able to make a confession, Easter, etc. We know what the church tells, especially this season and also otherwise. We are not able to make a confession physically for other limitations, the true contrition, sorrow, and the resolution that we are leaving the bad way, and at the next possible, feasible time when I will make a confession. And I'm sure you can partake of the celebration fully. And the timing of the coming Holy Week days, Mass timing, and other services.